all who are worshiping with us, whether here or online. In our worship together, may we find ourselves renewed in our faith, strengthened in our common life, and assured of God's love for each of us. My name is Linda Mills Woolsey, and I will be officiating this morning. First, I want to call your attention to the announcements in the back of the bulletin. There's a desk.
For Mary Ann Whitmore last night, and she's the coordinator for people that are sick, and etc. Her computer died, and she's in the process of getting it repaired. So if anybody needs to contact her, she has a cell phone, which I'll post downstairs. And if you need to contact her, she says, just text her on that cell phone, and she'll continue on, and she'll let us know when her computer's back. She's getting a new one, and it's taking some time to get it fixed.
Thanks, Bill. Any other announcements? Okay, do we have any birthdays or anniversaries today? No one really cares into that? So now is the time for the United Bank offering.
This morning I have a very contemporary thank you. I want to thank God for the attitude of so many Americans because of what happened to Salman Rushdie at the Chautauqua Institute yesterday. The attitude expressed by most is that we are a land of religious freedom, and we condone anybody's attack on someone because of the attacker's religious reasons. And I thank God for those people.
I want to give thanks to a couple of people in the crowd here. Number one, Stephen, I was down here the other day checking things out. He was working very hard. He was working as great as they have been. Appreciate his hard work. And Bob, as well, was assisting. Also like to thank Bob and Buzz, who's not here today. They went up on that second floor porch on the back. We cleaned off all that roof moss and stuff. And we got it really down to pretty good. And then I went back yesterday and scraped the field with the rubber spoon deep and vacuumed it. And now it's a place where if you wanted to, you could go sit. It's safe. It's, and it's clean. And we try to keep it clean and keep that moss in. So thank you for everybody's hard work.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on us. Forgive us all our sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Bring us to life Strengthen us in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep us in eternal life.
Amen. come before his presence with a song.
Know this, the Lord himself is God.
He himself has made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture.
Enter into his gates with thanksgiving, go into his courts with praise.
Give thanks to him and call upon his name.
For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting.
And his faithfulness endures from age to age.
And now, together, the Lord Pompey. Glory to the Father,
and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Reading from Isaiah 5, 1 through 7. Let me sing for my beloved my love song concerning his vineyard. My beloved had a vineyard on a very fertile hill. He dug it and cleared it of stones and planted it with choice vines. He built a watchtower in the midst of it and cleared it out of wine that he expected to yield grapes, but it yielded wild grapes. And now, inhabitants of Jerusalem and the people of Judah, judged between me and my vineyard. What more was there to do for my vineyard that I had not done in it? When I expected it to yield grapes, why did it yield wild grapes? And now I will tell you what I will do to my vineyard. I will remove its hedge, and it shall be devoured. I will break it down, its wall, and it shall be trampled down. I will make it a waste. It shall not be pruned or pulled, and it shall not be overgrown with briars and thorns. I will also command the clouds that they rain no rain on it. For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel. The people of Judah is pleasant planted. He expected justice, but saw bloodshed. Righteous, but he heard a cry. My soul hates. They have become a burden to me, and I am weary of bearing them. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Epistle of Hebrews 11:29-12. My faith, the people passed through the Red Sea as if it were dry land, but when the Egyptians attempted to do so, they were drowned. By faith, the wall of Jericho fell after they had been encircled for 7 days. By faith, Rahab the prostitute did not perish with those who were disobedient, because she had received the spies. And what more should I say? For time would fail me to tell of Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, of David, and Samuel, and the prophets, who through faith conquered kingdoms, administered justice, obtained promises, shut the mouths of lions, quenched raging fire, escaped the edge of the sword, won strength out of weakness, became mighty in war, put foreign armies to flight. Women received their dead by resurrection, and others were tortured, refusing to accept release in order to obtain a better resurrection. Others suffered mocking, flogging, and even chains and imprisonment. They were stoned to death, and they were sown in two. They were killed by the sword. They went about in skins of sheep and goats, destitute, persecuted, tormented, of whom the world was not worthy, and they wandered in deserts and mountains, and in caves and holes in the ground. Yet all these, though they were commended for their faith, did not receive what was promised, since God had provided something better, so that they would not depart from us and made perfect. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight sin that clings so closely, and let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, who for the sake of the joy that was set before him endured the cross, disregarding its shame, and has taken his seat at the right hand of the throne of God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to St. Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, "I came to bring fire to the earth, and how I wish it were already kindled. I have a baptism with which to be baptized, and what stress I am under until it is completed. Do you think that I have come to bring peace to the earth? No, I tell you, but rather division. From now on, five in one household will be divided, three against two and two against three. They will be divided, father against son and son against father, mother against daughter and daughter against mother, mother-in-law against her daughter-in-law, and daughter-in-law against mother-in-law." He also said to the crowds, "When you see a cloud rising in the west, you immediately say, 'It is going to rain,' and so it happens. And when you see the south wind blowing, you say, 'There will be scorching heat,' and it happens. You hypocrites, you know how to interpret the appearance of earth and sky, but why do you not know how to interpret the present time?" The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. Show us your ways, O Lord, and lead us in your paths. Guide us in your truth and teach us your will for us. For you are God, our Savior, and our hope is in you all day long. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. I feel silly wearing this hat, but I have to do it. Doctor's orders, so sorry. The title of today's homily is "The Cost of True Peace." And I'm indebted to the Right Reverend Frank Loeb, former canon of the ordinary in the Diocese of Georgia, for many of the words and ideas that follow. Sometimes gospel readings can leave us with an uncomfortable sort of feeling, maybe especially when the writer is St. Luke. Today's gospel is the perfect example. "Do you think that I have come to bring peace to the earth?" Jesus asks, and then answers, "No, I tell you, but rather division." These are disturbing and apparently aggressive words, and I vividly remember being bothered by them even as a child. But then it promptly gets worse when Jesus, the Prince of Peace, the human expression of God's love for us, goes on to say, "From now on, five in one household will be divided, three against two and two against three. They will be divided, father against son and son against father, mother-in-law against her daughter-in-law, daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law." At least to my younger self, that wasn't just puzzling, it was frightening. Isn't Christ's love supposed to heal wounds and bring people together, especially Christian families? Instead, this sounds like family chaos, like disaster. What has happened to Christ's message of love, forgiveness, and reconciliation? For some perspective, we know that Jesus himself experienced this especially distressing kind of separation, as his own family was torn by his ministry. While it's true that Jesus' mother Mary wants to be with him at the end, standing in horror and sadness at the foot of the cross as her son dies, can you imagine a more terrible moment for a family? It's also true that the Gospels tell us about the time when Jesus' family wanted to end his ministry and bring him home because they were afraid he had gone crazy, embarrassing and shaming the family. So when he speaks these disturbing words reported by St. Luke, Jesus is well aware that this is just the beginning of his troubles in ministry. A
and that his message of discipleship is certain to bring more misunderstanding and division, even as a new Christian community comes into being. 6 chapters further into Luke's gospel, Peter will say, "Look, we have left our homes and followed you." And Jesus will respond, "Truly I tell you, there is no one who has left house, or wife, or brothers, or parents, or children, for the sake of the kingdom of God, who will not get back very much more in this age, and in the age to come, eternal life." Jesus wants those who follow him to understand not just the rewards of this new life, but also the cost they will pay. This is the price of true peace. The word for peace in Hebrew is shalom, and it doesn't just mean the absence of personal conflict or war. The concept of shalom is much richer and deeper than that, suggesting personal wholeness, well-being and health, as well as what we think of as domestic peace and peace between people groups and nations. All these layers of meaning are present in shalom. Shalom is God's peace, which passes our human understanding. It's a true word. They strike us at first as anything but loving and peaceful. Jesus often sent those he healed on their way by saying, "Go in peace." Jesus makes them whole, healthy, and peaceful. He gives them a sense of well-being. And then he sends them away in that deeper peace called shalom. In his final word of peace in this gospel, Jesus appears to his disciples after the crucifixion. It's the first time they've seen Jesus since they betrayed him and ran away in fear to avoid the rest. Jesus doesn't mention their failures, just says simply and profoundly, "Peace be with you." Jesus, God's own son, was a man of peace who brought shalom, God's peace, to broken hearts and lives. And yet, in this Sunday's gospel, he says that he came to bring division. There's some paradox in this, and it can seem like a very hard truth. Jesus longs to bring deeper health and wholeness to our world, but sometimes the cost of that process will be division. Greater peace will only come at the cost of lesser peace. The true peace of God brings an end to false peace. And as Jesus says, sometimes pits family members against each other. How so? Lesser peace might look like family members keeping silent and crippling their own lives, enabling an abusive father to inflict untold emotional and physical damage because they're ashamed or afraid of letting those around them know that life at home is anything but ideal. Lesser peace might be a child falling into a drug addiction that consumes him or herself, and then the family, as denial continues until it is too late and the deadly addiction costs a life. Signs of marital infidelity might be everywhere, but sometimes it can seem easier to pretend not to see those signs than it is to face the fracture already present in the marriage. I'm sure you can think of your own good examples. We see the problems, but we say nothing because we're trying to keep the peace. Of course, this toxic pattern doesn't just apply to families. In this nation, the lesser peace treated formerly enslaved people and their descendants as less than fully human. The civil rights movement divided families precisely because the lesser peace came at no cost to those in power. It can seem tempting to want to return to the simple life with Andy and Opie Taylor in from the fictional world of Mayberry, without recalling that in that same time, if not in that fictional place, not all people shared the same peaceful lives, the same opportunities, the same rights. It's abundantly clear that even in 2022, we still have a long way to go before all of God's children experience the wholeness and well-being that are the shalom found in the reign of God. Jesus wants no lesser peace to take the place of true and lasting peace. But all too often we grab hold of a lesser peace as tightly as a child clings to a security blanket. Rather than having the courage to speak the truth in love, we remain silent, short-circuiting the possibility of real peace. Jesus continually reached out to the outcasts in his own society. Jesus upset the status quo and eventually was killed for rocking the religious and societal boat a little too much. Jesus did bring God's peace to the earth, a true and lasting peace, but, and this is the challenge of truth, the price of that peace was division and even his own death. So often throughout human history, people, maybe including us, have settled for a lesser peace when God was calling them to something more. The peace of God brings an end to false peace, which is a good thing, but it can easily pit even family members against each other, which is much more difficult and distressing. Living the new life in Jesus, which is promised in baptism, can and will change our behavior and our attitudes over time if we take that calling seriously. Living the promises made in baptism should change our lives. Yet this call to true discipleship may be in tension with our desire to avoid conflict, and so to preserve a lesser peace. That lesser peace does have its own price, though. The cost of the accommodations and compromises needed to preserve the appearance is that they get in the way of the deeper peace waiting for us if only we will embrace God's offer of shalom. Shalom, God's true and lasting peace, calls us to stand against lies, against injustice, against cruelty, against betrayal. Anytime we preserve the appearance of peace rather than embracing the real thing, we trade God's shalom or poor imitation. These can be tough questions to ask, but because real peace, shalom, is at stake, it's certainly worth facing the truth about ourselves and our own behavior. Where have we settled for fake peace, the absence of open conflict, instead of opening our arms to God's gift of the real thing? Where has our willingness to compromise on the truth for the sake of our own shallow, inauthentic peace come at the price of true peace for someone else? What would it look like to speak out against a false, lesser peace in our own families, in our communities, in our world? It's daunting when we consider the cost. It may divide a household, two against three, or mother against daughter. But if the Holy Spirit is speaking truth to our hearts, the Spirit is also leading us from a lesser peace to true, lasting peace. That's hard because Jesus has already warned us that the cost will be high. So high that even many of us who say we want to be Christ's disciples will shrink back and become lesser people rather than embracing the demands of the truth. That lack of courage often seems easy in the moment. But whenever we shrink back from thinking, speaking, and acting on what is true and just, we will fall short of the deep peace Jesus wants for us, our families, our friends, our places of work, our country, our world. So let's admit it.
Luke's gospel message for today is difficult and disturbing. But maybe this is the importance we should see in these harsh words. The real question is not why Jesus taught his disciples that following him might be divisive, but rather why our own lack of faith so seldom disturbs or challenges anyone in a redemptive way. In what ways are we holding back? How do we know when we should speak the truth and confront evil boldly instead of remaining silent? Here's the promise of this gospel passage. When we let God guide our words and actions through the Spirit, and when we speak that truth in love, what God will give us is not the division we fear, but rather the deep peace we long for. Amen. God give us the courage and grace to follow these challenging words in love.
Amen. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again, he ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
And now you can see the prayers. We'll begin the prayer with the Lord's Prayer on page 97. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Your salvation.
Clothe your ministers with righteousness.
Let your people sing with joy.
Give peace, O Lord, in all the world.
For only in you can we live in safety.
Lord, keep this nation under your care.
And guide us in the way of justice and truth.
Let your way be known upon earth.
Your saving health among all nations. Nor the hope of the poor be taken away.
Create in us clean hearts, O God.
And sustain us with your Holy Spirit.
And now let's read collectively the collect that is on the insert in the bulletin.
Almighty God, you have given your only Son to be for us a sacrifice for sin, and also an example of godly life. Give us grace to receive thankfully the fruits of his redeeming work, and to follow daily in the blessed steps of his most holy life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
And then, also reading together on page 98, the Collect for Sundays. So on page 98 at the bottom.
O God, you made us glad with the weekly remembrance of the glorious resurrection of your Son, our Lord. Give us this day such blessing through our worship of you, that the week to come may be spent in your favor, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen. And then on page 99 at the bottom, we read together the Collect for Peace, a prayer we need more than ever in our world. The Collect for Peace. O God,
the author of peace and lover of concord, to know you is eternal life, and to serve you is perfect freedom. Defend us, your humble servants, in all assaults of our enemies, that we, surely trusting in your defense, may not fear the power of any adversaries, through the might of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
And then on page 100, call it the guidance. We'll pray that one together.
Heavenly Father, in you we live and move and have our being. We humbly pray you so to guide and govern us by your Holy Spirit, that in all the cares and occupations of our life, we may not forget you, but remember that we are ever walking in your sight through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Confident in God's compassion, rule and enduring love, let us lift up the needs of the church, the world, and all of creation, saying, behold your children and responding.
And restore us, O God of glory.
Almighty Father, send the fire of your word to cleanse and refine your church and inspire in it the faithfulness of the saints. Following their footsteps, may we lay aside every weight and sin that clings so closely and run with perseverance the race that is set before us. Bless Michael, our presiding bishop, Steve, our provisional bishop, and our officials. Behold your children and restore us, O God of hope. Almighty Judge, you rule the earth with your justice and mercy. Guide the leaders of all nations to work for your justice and peace. Comfort and protect all members of our armed forces. Save the weak and the orphan. Defend the humble and the needy. Rescue the weak and the poor. Forgive us when we fail to be merciful. Behold your children and restore
us, O God of hosts.
Creator God, by your word you created the heavens and the earth. By your generosity you continue to cause growth. In your faithfulness you clothe, protect, and sustain your children. Lead us, O Lord, to be your hands and feet in caring for the whole world. Behold your children, and restore
us, O God of hosts.
Bless all those who have taught us to live faithfully. May our lives also witness to your Son Jesus, the pioneer and the perfecter of our faith. Behold your children,
and restore us, O God of hosts.
We pray for all who suffer and struggle, especially Don, Jerry, Holly, Lisa, Mary Lee, Penny, Liz, Betsy, Chuck, Megan, Mary Kay, Jeff, Kitty, Joanne, Dell, Susie, and may we keep in our prayers Alfred Yonder and also his family. Thank you. May they take comfort in knowing that you are not a God who is far off, but you are very near us, even filling heaven and earth. Behold your children.
And restore us, O God of hosts.
We praise you for all the saints, both famous and true, who surround us with their prayers, their encouragement, and their strength. Make us ever mindful of the great comfort that the witness of our earthly children. Behold your children.
And restore us, O God of hosts.
Give us passion, give us fire. Lead and guide us to transform the world from what it is to what you created it to be. Amen.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let's share socially distanced peace.
You have given us grace at this time, with one accord, to make our common supplication to you, and you have promised through your well-beloved Son that when two or three are gathered together in his name, you will be in the midst of them. Fulfill now, O Lord, our desires and petitions, and may it be best for us, granting us in this world knowledge of your truth, and in the age to come, life everlasting. Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
May the God of hope fill us with all joy and peace in believing through the power of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Thanks be to God. Alleluia. Alleluia. Before we finish today, I'm going to take you on a short tour of these wonderful flowers that have been placed by Stephen Woolsey and Bob. And I just wanted you to see these lovely flowers. We're taking a walk around the front of the church. Giving you a view of the bus stop. They are.
I just wish mine grew like that.
And I think we'll end with these lovely flowers and the sunshine. Have a wonderful week, folks, and we'll see you next week. Goodbye for now from St. John's.